you all, this is Marshita Anderson, and she is known to the world, the public world, as the wife, the first lady of Razorback basketball. She is the wife of Coach Mike Anderson, you know, and some of us just know her as Marshita. Those of us who are real close to her know her as Mar. I know her as my nearest and dearest friend. She's way beyond friends. She's at the sister family level. She's my sister, literally. It's way friend just doesn't seem to do it justice, so she's my sister. And we have 20 plus, gosh, 20, almost 25 years.
Longer. Yvonne was in your wedding.
Yeah, that was 22 years ago.
She's 26,
isn't she? Yeah, whoo. So anyway, we've been best friends for a long time. Before there was the limelight, before there was the head coach and stuff, way long before all that stuff, we've been very close friends and have journeyed a lot of miles in life together. Valleys, highs, lows, and everything in between. And so tonight I asked her, would she come and do this with me? Because we have been such supporters and encouragers and teachers of each other. Mm-hmm. And we just thought we would do this together to bring as many women as possible into this conversation, into these life lessons.
So, yes. If we interrupt each other sometime.
Yeah. We what?
It's okay. That's what friends do.
Oh, interrupt
when
me.
We're talking.
Yeah.
Because we can sometimes talk for each other.
Yeah.
So, just know that we're just buddies, and it's going to be very loose mm-hmm. in here. Okay? It's going to be fun. We're going to be fun. We laugh a lot together.
Yeah.
So, we're going to laugh tonight. I'm telling you. It's going to be good.
Okay.
So now.
All right. We do have some real specific things we want to share with you all. Did y'all get your She Is Pure Power handout? Everybody, did y'all get one? If you didn't, you'll need that. You'll want to have that because that's what we're going to be talking about tonight. Oh, thank you so much, Jermaine. Thank you. You're about to start singing. You scared you're going to start singing.
Girl, you know I'm going to sing. I told her I'm going to sing one day. She laughs.
Okay.
I think it's in me.
All right. So everybody got if you got your hand out, you see we have put this together. She Is Pure Power. And it's something I put together actually a couple of years ago. I was actually preparing to go and do some women's empowerment in a place where women really need to be empowered in Nigeria. And so I put this manifesto together for them. And I decided that we would talk about this tonight because I'm not certain that even here in the United States, in the midst of all the information and freedom and liberties that we have, that women really understand some of these truths, that we understand some of these things. And so that's what we're going to talk about. And when we have pure, when that word pure power right there really I said it that way to be catchy, pure power, so you'll remember. But it's really authentic power. It's authentic power. And tonight we're going to talk about authentic power. You know, whether you have whatever your educational level is, whatever your socioeconomic level is, whatever your social status is, your titles, what side of the track you live on, this power that we're talking about, the authentic power of womanhood, has nothing to do with any of that. This power that we're talking about, this pure power, is yours just by virtue of you being born a female. It is resident in every female. It's called womanhood. And so tonight we're going to talk about womanhood. And I know you say, I don't need to hear about woman. I am a woman. Well, I hope tonight that as we really talk about womanhood, and we're going to talk about it a lot from the scriptures, we'll be mainly in the book of Genesis because, you know, when you go back, if you want to know God's purest intent and highest intent for something, always go back to the beginning. In Bible study, they call it the law of first mention. You go back to where that thing was first mentioned. And so that shows you God's highest intent for a thing. In typically in its purest meaning, when you go back to where it was first mentioned. And so we'll go back to Genesis tonight as we walk through this manifesto, these seven manifestos about womanhood. And we're going to, I hope, reveal some things that are going to set you free. You know the truth when it sets you free. You've heard the truth when it liberates you. If it puts you in bondage, if it puts a cap on you, if it makes your life smaller than what it should be, if it zaps strength and life from you, it is not the truth. The truth liberates you. It sets you free. You've heard the truth when you feel like you can fly. You've heard the truth when you feel like you can soar. That's when you've heard the truth, because the truth makes us free. And so tonight, we're going to talk from the scriptures as we walk through these seven things that I call the manifesto. I call it the manifesto. It's about womanhood, the manifesto. I looked up the word manifesto, and this is what the dictionary says a manifesto is. It's a published verbal declarations of the intentions, motives, or views of the issuer. Another definition of manifesto is it's an individual's life stance. An individual's life stance. So when you put together a manifesto, it's a declaration of this is who I am. This is what I believe. Okay? That's a manifesto. So we believe these seven statements are the truth according to God's word about authentic womanhood. These are God's intentions, motives, and views about women. And we hope tonight that it's going to set you free. Not free to run off and do whatever you want to do, and free to, as the Bible says, God doesn't give us liberty to be loose. God sets us free to do what he has called us to do without hindrances and bondages and limitations.
Because, keep it holy.
Yes, ma'am. So liberty is not for lasciviousness or looseness. Yeah. You taught me this.
I did.
Yeah. Can I say this?
Yes.
Oh, Lord.
What?
I don't know. Ask your permission. I think I know you enough to know this will be okay.
It's okay.
But I remember, you know, when we all know her husband is the head coach, and that's lucrative. And, you know, when I remember when they first came into contracts, they were very lucrative. And you don't know you taught me this, but you taught me that when you are free, because that brought you into financial freedom and really the ability to do whatever you wanted to do. But you taught me that the more free you get, the more wisdom you have to have. Mm-hmm. And that freedom and wisdom have to grow together. Because that's freedom without wisdom, you'll hurt yourself and somebody else. You taught me that.
Yeah.
You may not have said it that way.
I was a good teacher.
Yeah, you're a good teacher. But we had these deep conversations, you know, and I've witnessed that from your life. Yeah. Is that the more free you are, you can do anything. You can do everything. You can buy whatever. Yeah. You can. Mm-hmm. There's typically no need somebody might have that you probably don't. You can help them. But you have to be wise. And so the more freedom you have, the more wisdom you have to have. They have to grow together.
I was saying that my spirit is generous. I am a giver. I mean, I love to give. That brings me joy to give. But the wisdom part of that, now that I have a lot to give, now I gave when we had nothing, okay? But now that we have a lot to give, I have to be very wise that it's the Lord telling me to give. If he says, he says to give $50 to someone, I give him $50. It doesn't matter that I have $200 or $300 in my pocket. I could give him all of it. But he said 50. So I do that. If he says to give $1,000, I give $1,000. Because he doesn't ask of me anything that I don't have to give. So I have to be careful now that we have more, not to make it about me. Because wisdom says I need to make sure that I'm not a little God to anybody. So that is what I was saying to Pastor Genette. So I think and I pray, and I know the Lord's voice, so I heed what he says when he says it at that moment.
Right. So tonight, this is going to be liberating, and it's going to be about freedom. But always remember that freedom and wisdom have to grow together, mm-hmm. or it can be destructive. Okay? Yeah, you're free to do whatever. In this day and age, women are so free. Women, especially in this nation, not in the mm-hmm. all over the world, but in this nation, we are free. And, you know, and we're so liberated, and the glass ceiling in many ways has been pierced, and we can climb as high as we want to climb and do whatever we want to do. And as a mother of six daughters, I'm grateful for that my daughters don't necessarily have the caps on them. Okay, mm-hmm. I'm grateful for that. But now we need wisdom. To help us know what to choose, when to climb. Mm-hmm. Does it make sense? Now, it is with women, we need wisdom like never before.
Yes, we do.
And I personally believe I don't hear enough voices of wisdom in this women's movement that
right.
we are in. I don't hear enough voices of wisdom. Because you can do it, but is it right to do it? Is it the time to do it? Is mm-hmm. that the right way to do it?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Everything that's good yeah. is not for now.
So we're going to teach you
yeah.
how to wield your power.
That's good, yeah.
As a woman.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, a woman.
Right.
Not having to be a man or wielding power as a man, but how to wield your power as a woman, the yeah. power that
God has given
God
you.
Has given you.
Absolutely. And you are powerful. Yes. So we're going to go to this first manifesto. It says, I am woman, the womb of all mankind. Not the womb of just one man, for those of you who are not married, you know. Not the womb of one man. I am Dexter Howard's womb. He does not have a womb. I am his womb. Okay? He doesn't have one. I am his womb. But beyond that, just the womb of one man, you're the womb, actually, you'll discover tonight, of all mankind. You're the womb of all mankind, and you are complex by design. It was mm-hmm. God's design. Without my touch, I wrote it in first person so you could say it, but without your touch, nothing can grow and thrive. Ladies, you are vital to life. Without the touch of a woman, nothing can grow and thrive. So let's go to the Word of God, Genesis 2 and 15. Genesis 2 and 15. And you all know this, but hopefully we're going to pull out some stuff from this that maybe you haven't seen before. Genesis 2 and 15. Then the Lord God took the man, whose name was Adam, and put him in the Garden of Eden to tend and keep it. So he created a man first, mm-hmm. and he put him in a place, a garden, gave him his sphere, and then gave him an assignment. That assignment was to do what, ladies? Tend. You can read your Bible. It was to tend and keep the garden. He gave him an assignment. It was to tend and keep the garden. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. Mm-hmm. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall die. So he gave the man a commandment, gave him instructions. And then the Lord God said, it is not good that man should be alone. Now, we talked about today mm-hmm. that We often say God observed that Adam was lonely and said it's not good for him to be alone. But I personally believe that it wasn't that Adam was lonely. I believe that God observed that Adam wasn't tending and keeping that garden too well by himself.
That's right. And he needed somebody to help him.
Y'all know men don't tend to keep the house too good, too well.
That's right.
I believe he observed it is not good that he is alone.
Nope.
And, but look,
somebody.
But look what he said. He said, he didn't say, I will make for him a companion because he's lonely.
Mm-hmm.
He said, I will make for him what?
A
helper. To help him do what? Tend and keep this garden because he can't do
in
it by
order.
Himself. Yeah. He made for him a helper. It wasn't good that he'd be alone because he couldn't do that assignment on his own.
Mm-mm.
He needed some help. You know, we've talked about this before, that my observation in my almost 20 years, I have been in the ministry over 20 years, 18 years of pastoring people, traveled a lot of places in ministry. And I know a lot of stuff. Not a lot of knowledge, but I've had a lot of experiences with people in their situations and circumstances, very up close and personal. And I have observed something, that men tend to love the woman who is helping them most. Their hearts gravitate to women, the woman who's helping them most, whether that woman is his mama, That's why his heart is, it's so hard to get his heart from. I'm pointing over there because my husband, that's his mom. His only child. He's an only child.
Yep.
And so it takes a long time. That's why it takes a long time to get your husband's heart from his mother. Mm-hmm. Because all those years she was helping him. And their hearts tend to gravitate toward the woman who's helping them the most. That's why they tend to have affairs with the help.
That's right.
Nannies, secretaries. Just know that about men. And we're going to discover it's because they need help, because they don't have a womb. And they cannot produce much of anything without a womb. Some woman to help them.
They have to have a woman.
They have to have a woman or a womb to help them. And we're gonna see this. Okay? So so God gave him a helper. And she was comparable to him. That helper wasn't just for his companionship. The woman wasn't just for his companionship.
Right.
But she was a helper to him. Yeah. Let's talk about the difference between men and women. We talked about that. You know,
this is a good one.
Physiologically, I kind of studied this the other day, and I didn't know. I knew it, but I didn't know it. Do you know physiologically, basically, men and women are the same. Our lungs, all of our lungs, our heart, our all our major organs are the same. They function the same. Physiologically, we are mostly alike, with the one exception, the reproductive system.
Uh-oh.
It is the only thing that distinguishes male from female is the reproductive system. That's where different.
Yep.
And it's almost like night and day.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to crack y'all up. And y'all going to know it's the truth. So a man's reproductive system is mostly on the outside of him. And it is very simple. Mm-hmm. It is external.
Yep.
And in the function of it, very straightforward and simple. Most of it. And it's made up of, mm-hmm. We got men in here, but anyway, we just going to talk like we girls, all right?
Sorry,
well,
guys.
Y'all already know this. Y'all know it's the truth, men know. But mm-hmm. their reproductive system is very simple. And the key words is external, and it's simple.
That's right.
Y'all know externally it's the penis and scrotum, and in that are the testicles. And then they've got a little bit of the reproductive system, just one little part called the prostate is on the inside. Mostly external, just a little bit. On the inside.
Not
mostly good. External, a little bit on the inside.
Mm-hmm.
And look, it's very straightforward. Their system is very straightforward. This is all their reproductive system does. Produces a seed in the testicle, releases it through the penis, their work is over.
5 minutes.
I'm serious. This is what you need to know. That's the only difference between us is the way we produce. That's what
That's
I want
it.
You to see. The
that
way we produce. His production is mostly external.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? You can see his power mostly externally. And they want you to see it. They take great pride in
yes,
flexing
they do.
It. They want you to see it.
They want you
and
to
And you
see
know
it.
When they are empowered. And y'all know what I'm talking about. All right? Everybody
right.
here should be
That's
18
right.
or older, all right?
Yep.
And it's external. That's why power to a man is really a lot of external stuff. His car, his house, his title, mm-hmm. how much money
his
he
job.
Has, his muscles, how he's built,
mm-hmm.
his muscles. You know, just, y'all, some of y'all raising little boys, you know, that. I don't know what age they start. What age they start flexing?
Three.
look. Girls don't be going around talking about. You know, girls, mine don't. I'm raising six. They have never come up to me and say, "Mom, is my muscle hard?"
No.
Not one of them has ever done that to me.
Mm-mm.
Not one of my
Mm-mm.
girls. Has any of your girls ever said,
Mm-mm.
"Mama, feel my
no.
muscle?"
No.
Even my muscle, my daughters who are athletes don't want you, don't be coming up to me telling me I feel my muscles. So their power is mostly external. Look, and it's straightforward. It's simple. Produce a seed, release it, finish.
Right.
They are straightforward, simple, concrete. They're simple. Oh, but let me teach y'all about y'all. About y'all. Let me teach y'all about y'all. Lord, look at a woman. So, a woman's reproductive system is mostly internal.
Yes,
you can't see it.
Yeah.
It's mostly a little external. One little part called the vulva is outside of the mm-hmm. reproductive system. All the rest of it is internal in what is called the uterus or the womb. And it is a complex system. It's not that simple for us.
But anything yeah. that brings life
it's
has
not
to be complex.
It's complex. And it's complex by design mm-hmm. because so much happens in the womb of a woman in order to bring forth that
That's
life.
Right.
Oh, my God.
Right.
What is happening in that woman's womb, and the most lot of it happening all at the same time.
That's right.
You know, her womb is multitasking in an incredible way. It's all, you know, the womb of a woman is always doing something.
Mm-hmm.
For those of you who are, you know, when you're in your child, especially when you're in your childbearing years. Yeah, when you're a child. Mine is on layoff right now. Mine is retired. But in your childbirthing years.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's mm-hmm. always doing something.
And we were saying that, you know, with our men, our husbands, mm-hmm. Because when that 5 minutes is over, our body's going, especially when you're in the reproductive, you know, that childbearing age, it's revving up. It's working all night, the next day. You know, if you're pregnant, you know it's 9 months. Everything is changing in you. Well, they're finished.
Yeah, they're done.
Going on about their business. Yeah. Don't nobody know they're pregnant? And here you are. You're getting bigger. Your body's changing.
Right.
It is so complex. You're nurturing. You're already nurturing. And you haven't even had anything yet. And your body is gearing up for that job.
Right. So the womb of a woman is essential. It really, it's what makes us essential. A man does not have a womb. He does not have a womb. Really, they said woe man is the womb of a man. Woe man. Now, listen, this is where I want to elevate and free your thinking here. Because that makes you feel like for some woman who is single, waiting to be married, or don't want to be married, or whatever, she's single, or she's never had a baby. If we just see that you're the womb of some man, you will feel like you are purposeless, inadequate, just whatever, without a man. I don't want you to see.
That's right.
Your natural womb is just, this is about your natural womb and one man. No,
right.
No. You are the womb of all mankind.
Mm-hmm.
That means that nothing can survive or thrive or grow without the touch of a woman.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing. No community can survive or grow or thrive without the touch of a woman. No church can survive or thrive or grow without the touch of a woman. No athletic team can survive mm-hmm. or thrive or grow without mm-hmm. the touch of a woman. No nation can survive or grow without the touch of a woman. You have seen it being in
mm-hmm.
India. I have seen
mm-hmm.
it in Haiti and Nigeria mm-hmm. and all mm-hmm. these other places mm-hmm. that I go. The nations that subjugate women are
mm-hmm.
third world nations.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They hold women back. They don't want educate them. They won't let them go to their full potential.
Right.
And the nation suffers.
Mm-hmm.
So when you educate a woman, you empower a woman, you release a woman to soar.
And let's clear something
up. It elevates everything.
Let's clear this up. You do not have to have a baby.
Yes.
Out of your womb.
Yes.
A living being out of your womb to affect this world as a mother.
Yeah, absolutely.
We mother other people's children
all
the time. So don't think that it makes you any less of a woman if your womb has not given birth to a baby.
Absolutely not.
You have given birth to many babies.
Right.
Go next door to your neighbor's children. They need some help. I'm just saying that you birth many different things as a woman.
Absolutely.
We're put here to be like, I call her Pastor Genette. I have to talk. Call her Pastor Genette in here because that's
call
her office. I know I'm going to call her Pastor Genette.
Okay.
As Pastor Genette said, to be a womb, but it is a womb to the world.
Yes.
And that's the bigger picture that we need to know.
Absolutely. That's the bigger. We want to elevate you that way. And what I want to say to some of you women, when you know that, when you understand that you are the womb and that nothing can grow and survive or thrive without you and your womb, I say this to you because I do know this. I'll take a risk and step out here because I know scenarios like this. Oftentimes, those of us who are married to men, because of hurt and pain and disappointments, you can shut off your womb to him. I'm not going along with no more of your ideas. I'm done with that. And you can start going off and doing your own thing. I know it's happening. And typically it's because of disappointment. You know, it's because you've been hurt. You know, I took a risk with you and it didn't turn out right. Now it cost you some loss or suffering or whatever, or he was unfaithful or whatever. It's out of hurt and disappointment. And so you shut off your womb to him. You stay married, but really you've shut off your womb to him. And he's frustrated because, remember, he cannot accomplish anything without your womb, without your help. He cannot do it without you. He can't do it without you. So remember that. You're the womb. You're the womb. Okay? Of all mankind, remember that without your touch, nothing can grow, nothing can thrive. All right, second manifesto. I am woman, created in the image of God. My thoughts, words, and deeds are a creative force. I am vital to life. Sister, you're so vital to life. Genesis 1:27 is where I got that one from. Genesis 1:27, it says, so God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. Mm-hmm. So it was not just man that was created in the image of God. You, as female, also were created in the image of God. What is that image? Well, I think the first thing about God, the first thing God revealed about himself is he is a creator. He is a creative being, and so are you. You are a creative being. It's tight, but it's right, and this is the truth. Mm-hmm. Every situation, circumstance in your life, everything that's happening in your world right now, everything that's present or is not present in your world right now, everything that's in your world that you enjoy or you don't enjoy right now, you just need to go ahead and own this. You help to create it.
Yes.
In some way, you created it.
Mm-hmm.
Or you helped to create it.
By your thoughts.
Yeah.
Oof.
Your words or your deeds. Whether it's just you, you know, right now, I know some people, so many of you, I already know it's in here because it's always in the room. You're struggling in your marriage. You don't like the marriage that you're in. Well, you know, the first thing you got to do is take some responsibility. You decide to marry him.
Yep.
It was your decision. I'm sure you had a choice. You decided. That was your choice. So in some way, see, it was your decision. And so I just said all that to say is that we have to own. You got to own that whatever is happening in your life right now, whether you love it or hate it, you helped to create it. That's a rhyme. Whether you love it or hate it, you helped to create it.
Mm-hmm.
That's good. Somebody write that down. Whether you love it or hate it, you helped to create it. Now, that might be a hard, bitter pill to swallow, but the reality is you're a creative being. That means that you can also change it. You can recreate it.
Mm-hmm.
If you created it, you can recreate it.
Mm-hmm.
You are a creative force.
Mm-hmm.
This is what you must know.
I tell this story sometimes about my husband. We were in our second house. We moved into this house, and we were standing on the front porch, and we were young. I think we were maybe 35, okay? So we're just standing there looking out across at the neighbors, and I said, honey, I said, can't you see us sitting here on this porch rocking our grandbabies? And he said, I can't see that. He said, I don't know what's going to happen.
Mm.
I went, what? You can't see it. You can't see us out here rocking our grandbabies. He said, I can't see that. I don't know what's going to happen in the future.
Mm.
Well, right then, I was like, oh, my God. He can't see a future. You know, I started going real deep. He was just making He was just probably very surface. I just can't see. You know, I can't see that far. But I was like, oh, he don't even think we're going to be together. He don't even know. He don't know if we're going to be together with grandchildren. What is going on? And I really got offended. And I said to him, you know what? I'll never ask you that question again because you obviously don't love me as much as I love you. And then something made me say, but you will. So I started walking past him as just a joke. And this is where my thoughts changed, because at first I was offended. And then my words changed because I said, but you will. And then every time I started passing him by, I would walk past him. And I, as he's getting ready to walk past, I put my hand on his chest and I look up at his face and I say, you love me so much that all you want to do is make me happy. And it was so funny at first. And I was just being, you know, just smart aleck. But then it got in me. And he started saying, mm-hmm. And he rolled his eyes. And so after about a year, no, I see, 2 years down the road, we moved into another house. And we were restoring it. And the builder called my husband to double check that I could do something at the house. So Mike came over, and he looked at me, and he said, this is who I need you to know. I love her so much. All I want her to do is be happy. Wow. And I went, oh, it works. It works. But what I figured out, though, was it worked both ways. Because after saying those words so often to him, because, I mean, I was repetitive in it, I started realizing that I loved him so much that all I really wanted to do was make him happy. And so for me, this being created in the image of God and my thoughts, words, and deeds, at that time my thoughts weren't right at that moment, but I changed my thoughts. I started using different words. My deeds changed after that because I started making different decisions, knowing how much he loved me and knowing how much I loved him.
So I want to show you guys real quick a little exercise to show you the power of your thoughts, the power of your words. And then if we get the thoughts and words right, if you get your thoughts right, because everything originates with thought, and then words, the deeds will line up easily. It's the thoughts and the words that really get us entangled. So I need a volunteer. I'm going to show you the power of your thoughts, the power of thoughts. Can I have a volunteer? It's going to be painless.
It won't hurt.
All right. Miss Alicia. Alicia. You, not you.
How about right here on the end?
I want to use this guest. I want to use this lady. I love you, Alicia, but you work for me. You get to talk to me all the time. You work for the church, rather not me. And so Kristen, we haven't met Kristen. Okay. So, let me. I'm gonna teach you this in front of all these people, okay? So, thoughts. Quantum physics have found that thoughts are energy. Thoughts literally are energy, which means they can be measured. Okay, thoughts being energy is a powerful revelation, a powerful discovery when they discover that thoughts are energy, because there's a law of energy. And it goes, I'm not a scientist, I'm a social scientist in a way, but I'm not a science scientist. But the law of energy says that like energy attracts like energy. Okay, like energy attracts like energy. And so if thoughts are energy, your thoughts attract, if the energy is a negative thought, negative energy is attracting negativity. Positive thoughts, positive energy is attracting positivity. In the metaphysical world, New Age world, they call it the law of attraction. But Jesus taught it. Jesus taught very much in line with it. It basically says the energy that you put out into the world is the energy that comes back to you. That's why he says don't judge so you won't be judged. That's why he says show mercy so you can get mercy back to you. That's why he says give generously so it can come back to you. Because the energy that you put out into the world is the energy that comes back to you. And thoughts are energy. Yes, thoughts are tied to emotion. Your thoughts trigger emotions. And I'm going to show you that right now. That's powerful. If you understand this, it changes the game. You are so more in control of your life than you know. But hope I'm going to teach you. So I'm just going to do this little exercise just to show you that thoughts are tied to emotion. Okay? All right? So, tell me, Kristen, tell us, what is the best thing happening in your life right now?
Freedom in my mind. I'm not bound to my thoughts, and my thoughts don't create the things that have been created in the past by the things that I've thought. I feel lighter.
You feel lighter? Wow. You feel lighter? Mm-hmm. Tell me a little bit what it feels like to feel lighter.
It doesn't feel like I can't do X, Y, and Z, or I can only do a certain amount of things. It doesn't feel limited. I'm a mother and a wife. She's my miracle. And
you had a miracle?
Yes, ma'am. I had a miracle.
You had a miracle.
Yes, ma'am.
She pretty?
Yes, ma'am. She is. Wow. She looks like her mom.
Wow.
Yes, ma'am.
Tell me about something else good happening in your life right now.
I'm happily married.
Ooh, what a blessing.
Amen.
Wow, you're happily. Tell me about that.
He was definitely made for me.
Wow. That is awesome. You're a blessed one.
Yes, I am.
Wow. Look at she. I got all of what is happening right now. You're being flooded with good things.
Mm-hmm.
All the good things is happening in your life right now. All of your energies. Your smile and your eyes are twinkling. As I am helping you think about good things.
Family members that are not in this good spiritual health that I'm in. Burdened.
Now, did you see that? Thoughts are connected to emotions. As she was thinking about all the good things that are happening in her life right now, choosing those good thoughts with my triggering. I'm there, I'm triggering. I was really in the driver's seat, driving her thoughts toward good. Because I already knew, because it works for everybody. I can do that with everybody in this room. Okay? You could be on your deathbed, and I can turn your thoughts to good. Because I know it's easy when you understand this. This is science. Okay? This is science. And then when I turned her thoughts towards something not so good, immediately she went. All that light, all that joy. I felt it. That burden came on her. Those tears. Now, you can choose at any time your thoughts. I encourage you, choose the thoughts that serve you. Mm-hmm. Choose the thoughts that empower you. Choose the thoughts that make you light. Filled up with light. Don't choose those. Refuse those that don't serve you. You can do it anytime. This is scientific, okay? That's why gratitude is so powerful. You know, I'll tell you about it. I wrote a book about it. Because it teaches you how to choose good thoughts. It'll change your life. It'll change your life. Thoughts are powerful. Now, the power of words. I need one more person. Words are also energy. Words are energy. It can be measured. One more volunteer. One more person. It's painless. Come on, Marla. My neighbor across the street is named Marla. Yeah, she's my friend. So, Marla, I'm going to show you the power of words because words are also energy that can be measured. Okay. So, if you can put your arm out here, which is your strong arm? Oh, you're a lefty. Okay. All right. So you feel, resist me. Get some muscles. Come on. There we go. I need to see your external power. You got some. It might not be much, but if you're like me, but you got some. It might not be like a man's, but we do have it. So, okay. You're resisting me. You're pretty strong. Wow. Okay. You're resisting me. All right. So now, Marshita, you come press on arm. I'll just talk so you can see this is not me. So do the exercise. See what it feels like right there as she's resisting you. That's her strength. That's represent. She's exerting a lot of energy, a lot of strength. Marshita can't press down on that. Now, words are energy. Words are energy. Jesus said the words that word, these words that I speak, they are spirit and they are life. But I say that these word, the words that you speak, they are spirit and they are life. Okay? So I want everybody right now to, this is going to be hard, Marla, okay, to hear this. But I want everybody right here to just say the ugliest, nastiest things, discouraging things. I know it's hard, but I've got to show you this. I want you to just say some real bad stuff to Marla. Say stuff like, you ain't nothing and you ain't going to never be nobody. Your mama wasn't nothing, your daddy wasn't nothing. You ain't this. Just, I know it's, it just be, yeah, everybody turn into the devil right now. You ain't even got to mean it. We know you don't mean it because we don't know. We don't even know anything about Marla to be saying this. But I've got to show you the power of words. Okay? Now, can y'all do it? I know this room's so full of love. Can y'all do it? I'll do it. Ready? Okay, press on it. Be strong, Marla. Be strong. Be strong. Marla, you're nothing. You're never going to be anything. You were nothing when you were born. You don't have any kind of future. You're going to die. You're weak. You're going to die. Yeah. You're not pretty. Who told you you're pretty? You're ugly. You're ugly. You're not worth anything. What was that doing? It was zapping all the strength out of her. You couldn't even resist it as much as you tried because of those words.
Can I say something?
Go ahead.
Oh, thank you. Well, I'm kind of like that person that said, you know, let's build the fire, and then the serpent came up out of it and grabbed it. I am recently a survivor of domestic violence, of 12 years of marriage to an abuser. It was very difficult to leave, and I kind of feel that way, like you could have all given it to me at this point, and it wasn't going to matter, because I know who I am, I know who I belong to, and so it's, I love this so much, but can I say one more thing before I sit down? When we were talking about we all choose things that, you know, your circumstances, you have to own them. 1 in 3 women in this room statistically are in a domestic violence situation. You never chose that. You never chose that. You never chose.
You chose him, but you didn't choose. You didn't choose. You didn't choose that. You didn't choose to be abused. That's good. That's a rhyme. We rhyming tonight. All right. Come on. No, I'm not done. No. Come on. We got to build her back up.
But you can choose to get out of
you
it.
You can choose
that's what
to
I'm
get
saying.
Out. Yes, you can
choose to get out of it.
Yes, you can. All right. So. Is this one getting tired? That's okay. Well, no. Let's build this one back up. It work needs to work with this. Did you feel her being? Do you feel the weakness? Did you feel it? Yeah, she's a strong girl. But you felt the weak. You felt her being weakened by those words. Okay, as much as you know who you are and all that kind of stuff, but my words were zapping all the strength out of you. And I have not, I didn't touch you. All right, let's do it again. Now, come on, let's do it all together. Let's build her back up. We can do this. Come on, encourage her. Come on. This works. I want somebody else to feel this. I need one more volunteer. I want you to feel this so you understand the power of your words that you have in your mouth right now. I understand that I have in my mouth. I love when I saw this, I saw the power of what I do for a living because this is what I do for a living. I preach, I teach, I motivate, I encourage. I get on the stage and go crazy with the word of God, pumping life into people. I know what's happening. I know what I'm doing. I am strengthening you because words are powerful. They are energy. And I want you to leave out of here feeling like a superhero because I know the power of words. Okay, to build up or to pull down. One more person so you can see what it feels like for you that the words are powerful. One more person. Just one more person. Okay, come on. This works with anybody. I've done this with my husband who thinks he is the Hulk. I did this exercise with him. Girl, them words ain't going to bother me. Come on. Come on, girl. Girl, them words. I ain't worried about them words. And his little arm would just. Say it works. You can't resist it. It's energy. It's real. Let's do it one more time. Charity. Charity, you're ready. You know I love you, don't you? All right, these words are just lies. Okay, who do you think you are? You're nobody and you're nothing. I don't even know why you were born. You weren't even meant to be born. You weren't meant to be born. You don't have any purpose. You're nothing and you are nobody. You see that? She couldn't resist that. Zapping all the strength out of her. Let's build her back up. Charity, you are more than a conqueror. You were born for a purpose. You are destined to win. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. You are beautiful. You are glorious and you are victorious. God's got a mighty plan for your life. It's real. You have in your mouth, sisters, the power to build up or tear down anytime. You can make your children feel like they can soar and conquer anything, or you can make them feel like they don't have enough sense to go across the street. You can make your husband feel like he is a superhero, or you can make him feel like he is a nothing and a chump and never going to be nobody. It's all in your mouth. Words are powerful. And then if you get your thoughts in your mouth aligned, thoughts, choosing power thoughts, and choosing powerful words, and speaking those powerful words, the right deeds are going to follow. That's how you create in your world. You are a creative force. Boy, we got to run now.
Running shoes.
Running shoes. Number three, you are a woman. You yourself are blessed by God to be profitable and have dominion in your assigned sphere. That's Genesis 1:28. Then God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it, have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. The point is that God blessed them, the man and the woman, and said to them, be fruitful and multiply. And if you're like me, probably the first thing you think about is he blessed the man and the woman together, because we know when men and women hook up, we procreate, right? So, and you think that, you know, the blessing is on men and women to get together, you know, as husband and wife, or man and woman, because you certainly don't have to be husband and wife, and procreate, right? But I think it's bigger than that. Because what if you're not married? Or what if you're not married but don't have a man? Okay? That means that you can't be fruitful and multiply. I believe that God didn't just bless them together. He also blessed each individually. So that means that without a man, you can still be fruitful and multiply. Being fruitful just basically means being profitable. Okay? With a man, great. Without a man, great. Because you are blessed individually. Right? Didn't you say that today? What did you say on the way here? You are blessed individually.
And you have your own blessing.
Yeah, you have your own blessing.
You have your own blessing.
You have your own blessing. So without a man, you can still be profitable.
Now, we're not talking about multiplying like babies without.
Yeah, we ain't talking about that. Don't do that.
We ain't going there.
Mm-mm. But you can be profitable, and you can have dominion in your assigned sphere. Having dominion,
that's
to me,
right,
just means rising to the top.
Mm-hmm.
In your assigned sphere. Mm. With a man, wonderful. Without a man, you can still do that. You are blessed individually. Okay? I say that, I think that's so important, because so many women just they wait for life to happen until they get married. I was watching Oprah's show. I had Deanna do some research because I know you lived in India, but I didn't have time to do the research. But I remember watching Oprah Winfrey's show. She took a tour, spent some time in India, and she was doing her show and all this stuff about India. And it stuck with me. She toured this place in India. It is a place where women who are barren, so by a certain age, if they haven't had a baby by a certain age, they're barren. They are sent to this isolated place to wail. That's what they do, is they go to that place and all they do is just wail, because their whole purpose as a woman somehow was tied to this. And so if she cannot produce, or she does not produce a child, she has no purpose.
She's unworthy.
And so she's unworthy, and so they are sent off to wail. Do you know, right here, there are women who are doing this right now in our culture. They may not be wailing on the outside, but on the inside, they're just wailing. I don't have a man. I don't have a man. They have just relegated themselves to wailing. But you're blessed individually to be profitable and to have dominion in your assigned sphere. I was telling you earlier, every time I do this one, I think about my spiritual mother, my little town in Arkansas called Forest City. Her name is Abigail Robinson. And Abigail is probably going on 60 now. Never had a husband. She's never been married. Bona was just a serious woman of God. Abby has never been married. She has never had a child. She was a teacher all of my years in Forest City. And then she, of course, she became the principal of our school, retired as a teacher, you know, and then now is in her second career. Abby is so blessed. It's absolutely ridiculous. She's just so blessed. Never been married, never had a child. She was telling me when she was at my mama's funeral a few weeks ago, she was telling me that she's so blessed that she just sent her brother and her nephews, all of them, on her ticket to the Super Bowl. She's so blessed. She's paying for two or three of her godchildren's education. She is so blessed. Thank God Abby didn't wait for life to begin until she got it. And she still believes God for her husband. But she's so blessed until it's like, if they come, they come. If they don't, child. She's so blessed. Thank God she didn't wait for a man to come along to rescue her before she just went ahead and lived her purpose and did what God was calling her to do. Mm-hmm. She's got so many children. Her womb, her natural womb has never received a seed. But she's got so many children. Mm-hmm. I am one of them. That's what I'm saying. Every time I see that, I think about Abby. Mm-hmm. So, yes, you're procreating with a man and being the womb of one man. All that's all wonderful. It's got its benefits. Praise God. Mm-hmm. I'm grateful for it. But without that, you still are blessed by God to be profitable and have a dominion in your assigned sphere. Mm-hmm. Let's move on. You got something, Mar?
Yeah, I got something. Okay. I'm number four.
Go ahead.
I am woman. She gave me this one, y'all. Yeah. I'm trying to keep quiet because we have our running shoes on. We're trying to get to the end. I am a woman. I am woman, uniquely crafted to make my world a beautiful place to live in. I am vital to life. Now, I am woman. Y'all, look at me. I am woman, right. Uniquely crafted. And so what I was saying to Pastor Genette was, when I thought about this, I thought about Solomon. Solomon had the right words for a woman, y'all. Sometimes just reading Song of Solomon, well, it's so explicit. So, but I wanted to just to read a little bit about what he said about the woman that he loved. He said, "How fair you are, my love," he said. "How very fair. Your eyes behind your veil remind me of those of a dove. Your hair makes me think of the black wavy fleece of a flock of the Arabian goats, which one sees trailing down Mount Gilead beyond the Jordan on the frontiers of the desert. Your teeth are like a flock of shorn ewes, which have come up from washing, of which all are in pairs and none is missing among them. Your lips are like a thread of scarlet, and your mouth is lovely. Your cheeks are like halves of a pomegranate behind your veil. Your neck is like the Tower of David built for an arsenal, whereon hang 1,000 bucklers, all of them shields of warriors. Your two breasts are like two fawns, like twins of a gazelle that feed among the lily. Until the day breaks and the shadows flee away, in my thoughts I will get to the mountain of myrrh and the hill of frankincense to whom my soul adores. Oh, my love, how beautiful you are. There is no flaw in you." So when I read that and I get to this, y'all, this is in the Bible, y'all. I'm not reading a romance. This is in the Bible, but it is a romance. And I think it's so interesting that the Lord wanted it put in the Bible. I think he wants us to know who we are in all our womanly attributes, how beautiful we are, each one of us, in our own way, because he created all of us.
And we were created for beauty.
Created for beauty.
Yeah.
Even if you can't make beauty in your home, somebody can help you. See, I mean, there's just a creation that's going on in us, but we have to get our minds right to realize really how beautiful we are. I didn't think I was beautiful when I was young. Matter of fact, I thought I was very ugly. You know, the guys tease me. You know what they call bullying now? It was just mean. I just wasn't a cute girl. I didn't develop until I was almost 17. And so I know what it feels like to be not held as, not looked upon as being beautiful. So I think it's so funny today when people say to me, "You're beautiful," and I go, "Okay, thank you." I do, I really do. And maybe that was to keep me from having any type of vanity, because I know that the beauty is Christ. I know that's Him. It's just coming out. So, but when I think of us and when I think of our beauty and how you are crafted to be a beautiful woman, what we said is, when we were talking about it, is you know, when you're beautiful, you can be a seductress. You can seduce anyone. When you have the right attitude, you can seduce anyone. Now, you don't want to be a seductress unless it's in your own house, but your own husband, correct? In your home, that's with marriage. And then, and what we said is,
Nicole, you get ready. But we were talking about women. Women, we were created by God for beauty and for pleasure.
Right. Both.
We really were. We're both. And the women who know that and own that and abuse it are called seductresses. They're called seductresses.
You have to always know how to wield your
right.
power.
They're
in
called
every
seductresses.
Area.
But you need to know it and then know how to use it.
And
you
own
were
it.
Created for beauty. You were created for pleasure, and that includes sexual pleasure,
mm-hmm.
but not just to receive it, but also to give it. And the reality is women, we are sexual objects. We are objects
yes.
of desire. We are.
That's right.
You were created that way.
Mm-hmm.
You were created for beauty. You were created for pleasure. That's what Song of Solomon says. That man was just looking at that woman and just taking her in.
Drooling.
He was drooling over how she was crafted.
Yes, he was.
Your breasts are like this, and your lips are like this, and your hips are like this.
And your skin is like this.
And his skin is like this. And he was drooling over what God had created, because woman was created for beauty and for pleasure. So the woman who knows that and abuses it is called a seductress. But the woman who knows it and knows how to use it is powerful. Because, sis, that is your leverage
mm-hmm.
with a man. Okay, now this real girlfriend, young, old women teaching young women stuff.
That's right.
That is your power with a man.
That is
y'all
your
better
power
hear
with a man.
Me. Mama Webb, do you need to come
Don't.
Up here and tell them? Huh? Y'all got to make me get off my seat on this. I'm raising 6 daughters now. That is your power.
That is your power.
With a man. You were created for
Don't
beauty.
Deny it.
And pleasure. And the woman who understands that, young women, because this section is all about y'all, young college girls.
Yes, it
a
is.
A single woman, but mostly y'all young college girls. We got to teach you this. Your power is. That is your power. And every time you give that power, you give that power away. Every
That's
time
right.
you just give that away, you're losing your power.
That's right.
Look at all these older women telling y'all better hear, y'all see these women on the stand. Amen?
Yeah. Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm telling you. So you when you just give that away, you are giving yeah. away yeah. your power.
Keep
because
your
that
power.
That is your power. That is your power. You keep
don't
that.
Don't give it away like
don't
that.
Don't give that away like that. I'm training my daughters. I was telling her this, and mm-hmm. I've said this in women's meetings before, and it's just, it's my truth, and it's the way I'm training my daughters. You be the wife for nothing at all. Baby's mm-hmm. mamas don't get no honor.
Mm-mm. None.
Baby mamas get no honor.
This is for singles,
yeah.
too.
This is for singles. Baby, you
Not
be the wife
young people.
Or nothing at all.
Mm-hmm. So,
if you can't be the wife, you won't be anything. Other women, mistresses get no honor. Mr. just might be getting his legs and getting his stuff, and he might have bought you a house, but if something happened, ain't nobody, honey, you're going to be on the back row of that funeral. That wife going to be up there with all the honor, all the money, all the everything.
All the glory.
All the glory. The wife gets everything. So you be the wife or you be nothing.
Right.
Your power is in no.
No.
Young women.
Your power is in
your
no.
Your power is in no.
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 So there's this song. My twins, I have 12-year-old twins. And so when I'm picking them up or whatever, there's a little pop tune station they listen to. And I usually am tuning out the little pop songs they're singing. But there's this one that I realize when this one comes on, they turn it up. You got it. You know where I'm going. When this song comes on, they turn it up. And it took me a while to figure out what's going on with this little song.
It's a great song.
And I listened to it. Oh, I said, oh, I love this song.
So she started turning it up even louder.
So I turned up loud. Now when it come on, I be singing it. I be singing it. Y'all, I'm sorry. Forgive me. I really am. I know how to talk right, but I got a little loose. So I just want them to sample a little bit of that song.
Yeah.
You gotta say yes. My name is no. My sign is no. My number is no. You need to let it go. You need to let it go. Need to let it go. I to the no, no, no. My name is no. Sign is no.
My sign is no. My number is
you
no.
Need
you need to let it go, brother.
You need to let it go.
No to the no to the no, no, no.
Untouchable, 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 untouchable.
No to the no to the no, no, no.
Untouchable.
That's y'all's word.
No.
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 The. No.
My name is no. My sign, no.
No.
My number is no.
Can I dance? No.
If you listen to the song a young girl is talking about, you're not going to get on the dance floor, but y'all, I don't want your hands all over
me. No.
I mean, she's talking that thing. She's like, it's no. So when that one comes on, my twins, I mean, they know every word. My name is no. My number is no. My number, no, 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 no. I didn't know what they were saying. I listened to the song. I was late. I started singing it. My name is no. My number is no. Come on, girls. No, 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 no.
No. No.
You keep saying no until he says, will you marry me? And then you say,
yes. Yes. That's your only yes.
That's your power, girlfriend. You make him fight
Keep
for
your
you.
Keep your power. That's right.
You so, make him fight for you.
With that in mind.
With that in mind, we thought, we feel so strongly about this. As women who've made some mistakes and done some things and should say yes when we wish we had said no.
Ooh, good God.
We thought we'd just give some prizes away. We got these made today for you, for some of y'all young single college girls. Just to encourage you, no! No!
Come get it. That's a small. That is a small.
No.
Somebody come get it. Who wants this one?
Who wants it?
Come
no.
Get it. Come
My
get
husband
it.
Said, do y'all gonna have enough for the girl? Can you bring the girls back some?
Come get it.
No.
Here.
Just say no.
Single?
Just say no. Don't give up your power like that, that easy. Just say no.
And we mean that.
We mean that.
Woo. Learn to say no. Don't say be no. A yes person.
Say no. You can just say no. And no means no. No.
And you don't have to scream it. Just say no. No.
And mean
That's
it.
More powerful.
Yeah, and he really will.
I mean, I'm on a serious front.
Yeah.
That's really more powerful.
Yeah.
You just look at them and you say no.
No. No. Yep. I think y'all got the point
Enough
on that
said
one.
On
Don't
that.
Give up your power. All right, we got a few more, and these are easy because you all, as women, know this. Mm-hmm. I am woman, number 5, born with a special strength, grace, and resiliency to overcome pain. Yes. Overcoming pain has more to do than just overcoming the pain of childbirth because we know we've all, most of a lot of us have done that, and you do overcome it. Mm-hmm. You know, it's horrific while it's happening, but it's amazing when the baby comes. It's kind of, it's over. You know, but that same resiliency, we overcome a lot. Mm-hmm. We can overcome a lot. The same resiliency that caused you to overcome the pain of childbirth can cause you to overcome the pain of heartbreak. Mm-hmm. you can overcome. We have a resiliency to overcome pain differently than men.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I have discovered through my work with people that, and this is through social research as well, that social research has found that women even bounce back after divorce more quickly than men do. They tend to bounce back more quickly. They're a little bit more resilient than men. Well, if you break a man's heart, his heart doesn't heal real quickly. Some men, you break their heart, they never love again.
Because
that pain was so deep for them. They a lot of them never put their heart back out there.
That's why it takes so long for you, if you are married to a man who has a broken heart, or who has had a broken heart.
Yes, ma'am.
It takes a long time to really get that trust in him. I mean, you have to truly earn it.
Yep.
No. Unfortunately, you don't know what happened in his life before.
Right.
So you just have to stay patient and have some wisdom and just really stay in your marriage. That's why you have to be committed and you have to fight in those marriages, because you really don't know who his heart was broken by.
Yep. Right. And so I think it's a special strength that women have, a special grace, a special resiliency to overcome pain. Leverage that. Know that. That's how you were created. Use that for your benefit. Know that about yourself, that you have a resiliency to overcome pain. You were endowed with it. And then the sixth one, women are endowed with the right to pursue freedom and happiness. You are endowed with it.
And what we want you to really focus on is you have the right.
Yes.
It is a right. You are endowed with the right.
That's right.
No one can take that away from you.
Right. You have a right to pursue freedom.
No one's giving it to you.
And happiness. This meant a lot to me when I wrote this. This meant a lot to me because I was just coming out of a season of... been married 22 years and six children. And I'll be honest, I probably spent the first 15 of those years, I was the sacrificial lamb. And I just felt like I was just one big machine, meeting the needs of everybody, having babies, helping my husband do everything he needed to do, helping him build the church, helping him get the, you know, I realized I woke up after 15 years of marriage, I was about to turn 40. And I woke up one day and realized that I had built this beautiful, created through my womb this beautiful family. We lived in a beautiful home. All this stuff was going on. Everybody was happy but me.
I remember when she woke up, y'all.
Yeah.
Her husband was like,
who is she?
Something's happening.
What happened to my wife? Yeah, this real talk right here.
Yes.
But I realized everybody was happy but me.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody's needs were met but mine. And I realized, that ain't God.
Nope.
Hey, I'm a part of this family too. You know? What about me? You know? It took me, I wanted to take y'all that long. It took me a long time. It took me years to realize I had the right to be happy and have my needs met as everybody else in the house did. Yeah.
We always think that we have to be the sacrificial.
Yeah.
That we have to make all the sacrifices.
Yes, ma'am.
No. Or, I don't know. I don't know that that's inbred. Maybe that's from watching our parents, our mothers.
Yeah, we just watch
do the
sacrifice.
Same thing. Maybe it's a taught thing.
But they were unhappy.
They were very unhappy.
They were very unhappy.
I know Christ didn't expect us to. Mm-hmm. That's not what he put in us.
Yes.
So I think it's a learned behavior.
Yeah, I think it was a learned behavior. That's all I watched my mama do.
Yeah.
To death, like she just died a few years ago.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
You know, my sister's in here, and they know it's the truth. That's all I watched her do,
mm-hmm.
was sacrifice and suffer. That's all I watched her do.
And I'm not saying that some sacrifices don't
come. Oh, you're going to have to sacrifice now. Yes, ma'am.
You're going to sacrifice
yes.
some things. But we were talking about things as simple as, why is it if there's not enough food in the house, the mamas don't eat? Everybody else eat. Okay.
Well, there's not enough money.
Or how about clothes?
Or clothes.
You don't buy you a stitch of new clothes.
But you, everybody else
good.
Decked out in the house.
Husband.
And you walking
fine.
Around with all leftovers.
Yeah.
My mother-in-law taught me that. I will give her honor while she's alive. My mother-in-law. I remember her saying one day to her son, basically teaching him how to take care of a woman. It's basically, no, if somebody needs some shoes, she gets them. That's your wife. she gets it.
Come on.
You see? But so I think it's that, like you said, I know in my case it was a learned behavior, and I thought I was just being a good wife. Oh, but when the lights came on. Oh, my husband, he still is learning the new me. I think he likes me. Some days I don't know. He likes me. Yeah, he likes
me. He likes her.
Yeah. But I guess he realizes now, you know, we're long past that now. But sometimes I take good care of myself now. And I don't wait on him to take good care of me. I have learned to value and honor myself enough to I take care of me. If I'm managing a budget, right? Because I manage the budget, I make sure I get included. So I have my line, hair, nails, shopping allotment. Everybody else got to have food and clothes and what they need, right? So I have a line. I include myself.
I don't
You've
know
got to do it for yourself.
That I ever had that problem.
Yes. No, you didn't.
I don't think I had that problem.
Yeah.
My husband has always said that I'm high maintenance.
Yeah.
And, you know, I just accept that. That doesn't make me stupid. Now, I'm very wise when it comes to money. But I just know who I am in this life. Once I realized who I was and who my father was, I was like, wait one second. My father has a cattle on how many hills?
Yes, she does. She's telling the truth, y'all.
I did. Once I realized that, I was like, I am very wealthy. And I just started
walking in that. Long before she
was
wealthy. Y'all, that's just the truth.
Mm-hmm.
Long before. So, ladies, I want you to know that you're endowed with the right to pursue freedom and happiness. You have the right, like everybody else in your household. You know, you have the right. And stop waiting for somebody to give you permission and do stuff for you that you can do for yourself. You know what makes you happy.
That's right.
Do that for yourself.
Right.
Yeah, that resonates with you all. I know a lot of you are raising children, raising families, and we're need meters, and we can just put ourselves on that altar as a sacrificial lamb.
Yes, we do.
Get up off of that. Jesus is a sacrificial lamb. You're not.
Get off that altar. That's right.
Get off that altar.
Now, don't be crazy.
Get off that altar.
Everything's in order.
Make sure you're being taken care of. That's what I'm saying. Include you in the mix of the needs that need to be met. Self-care is not selfish.
Right.
Self-care is not selfish. Okay? It's not selfish. You've got to. And people, there's all this research about happiness. Success does not create happiness. Happiness creates success.
That's right.
So when you're feeling well and feeling like you have positive emotion and feeling like you're taken care of and things are well with you, it makes you more successful. It makes your whole house happier. All right.
That's right.
Last thing, you are a woman. You're worthy to be loved and treated with special care.
Y'all know that, right?
Do you know that?
That you are worthy.
That you are worthy
to be loved. Nothing that you did, but there's something that he did.
Right.
He made you worthy. And once you get that literally, once you understand that, maybe I take this word right here too literal. One time, Pastor Ness said, you take that thing literal, don't you? I do. And once you realize that Christ made you worthy, you're gonna get it. You're going to stop letting people walk over you. You're going to stop being a sacrifice. You're going to become all these things right here. Yes, it's all about self-worth.
It's all about self-worth. You have to feel worthy. You know, you can tell when a woman doesn't feel unworthy, you give her a compliment and she just deflects it. Mm-hmm. Oh, this old dress, oh, this hair, oh, this old.
Just say thank you.
I just paid $5 for these old things. Just say thank you.
Oh, your teeth so pretty, girl. I just got these dentures the other day.
Or the Lord has blessed you and you start apologizing for how blessed you are.
Yeah.
You know, people come into your house with, oh, somebody gave me that. Oh, it didn't cost nothing. Well, you got to apologize. Just say thank you. Say, oh, yes, God is good.
Yep.
You get a new car or whatever. People say, ooh, that's beautiful. Oh, you know, we got it on. You know, I got it at an auction or whatever. Dude, you ain't got to say all of that.
Nope.
Just say thank you. God
is
good.
Thank you.
I say it all the time. God is good.
God is good.
Woo! Woo, you look good for having 6 kids. Yeah, God is good.
Mm-hmm.
God is good. Because he is. Come on, everybody say that. God is good.
God is good.
That's all you got to say. Thank you. God is good.
Mm-hmm.
I feel that. Let that soak in. Just say, thank you. God is good.
Thank you. God is good.
And keep moving. Yes, ma'am. Y'all got it? Let's say these together, and then we'll be done. Almost done, because we got to do one more thing, a couple more things. All right. This is our manifesto. Can we say these together? Number one, let's go. I am woman, the womb of all mankind, and complex by design. Without my touch, nothing can grow and thrive. I am vital to life. I am woman, created in the image of God. My thoughts, words, and deeds are a creative force. I am vital to life. I am woman, blessed by God to be profitable and have dominion in my assigned sphere. I am vital to life. I am a woman, uniquely crafted to make my world a beautiful place to live. I am vital to life. I am woman, born with a special strength, grace, and resiliency to overcome pain. I am vital to life. I am woman, endowed with the right to pursue freedom and happiness. I am vital to life. I am woman, worthy to be loved and treated with special care. I am vital to life. That last one, I forgot to say this one point that you need to know, ladies. You are the gift. You are the gift, not just to a man, but you are the gift to mankind.
Mm-hmm.
You are a gift to mankind. When God made woman, it says that he made her, took her from Adam's side and crafted her. And then he said, and then he presented her to the man, which means you are a gift. He might forget that. He shouldn't, but he might. But you never forget that. What becomes dangerous is when you forget it.
That's right. That's right.
And then you start allowing any old kind of treatment. Mm-hmm. You become a doormat for somebody to walk all over you and just let some man or anybody treat you any old kind of way. Don't you ever forget, you're the gift.
And most gifts come in wrapping.
Yeah.
Your wrapping is beautiful.
Yes.
It's not wrinkled. It's not old. It's fresh and new. Your wrapping is beautiful. So just remember that.
Mm-hmm. That's, I believe, authentic womanhood. What do y'all think? Praise God.
Praise
and it's in every
God.
Woman right now. No matter what your status is, your educational attainment, your title, or whatever it is, this has nothing to do with any of that. This is resident in you right now by virtue of you being a woman. You are powerful already. You're already powerful right how you are. We'll be right back.